Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, welcome to the seminar by Center of Public Studies and the Institute of Challenges for Democracy, the Field of Democracy, about compared experiences in process of constitutional harmonization. As we know, the Harmonization Commission of the Constitutional Convention will be formed by 40 constituents and will start sessioning between May 17 and June 9th. To discuss these issues and also learn from experiences that we may learn from other constitutional experiences regarding constitutional harmonization, we are joined by, there is hardly a better speaker than who we have today, and we are deeply thankful to all of you for accepting our invitation. In the first place, we are also joined by Professor Rudiger Wolfram as the speaker for today. Professor works as an academic international law in the University of Heidelberg, and also as a honorary director of the Max Planck Foundation for International Peace and also the Rule of Law. And before that, he also worked as director of the Max Planck Institute of International, Public Compared Law and International Law, and also a judge of the International Court for Maritime Law between 1996 and 2017, having also worked as its chair between 2005 and 2008. Thank you so much, Professor, for being here with us today. And we're also joined by two commenters that couldn't hardly be any better. And Maria Valenza Valeria, is a professor and sub-director of the Institute of Political Sciences of Pontificia Universidad Católica of Chile, and a member of the political scientist, master's in political science from the University of Princeton. On the other hand, Samuel is a professor at the Faculty of Law of the Adolfo Ibáñez University and has a PhD in law from the London School of Economics and Political Science. Thank you so much, Valeria and Samuel, for joining us today. And before giving the floor to Professor Rudiger, very briefly, some details about how the event is going to be conducted. We are going to start with a presentation by Professor Wolfram around the 15 to 20 minutes, and then we'll give the floor in alphabetical order to Valeria, then Samuel, up to 10 minutes. The idea is that after that, we can start having a series of questions from either the audience or our commenters in order to learn from the experience of Professor Wolfram in constitutional harmonization processes. Those who are following us from the various platforms can also send us your questions to preguntas@cepchile.cl. Preguntas@cepchile.cl. So, without any further ado, Professor, you have the floor. Muchas gracias por su presentación. Estoy muy agradecido por tener la oportunidad de venir a este muy importante e influyente think tank, y me honra estar aquí para poder compartir mis pensamientos sobre lo que ustedes llaman armonización constitucional. Y sin embargo,
subject, since I've been speaking about that now altogether perhaps 6 hours, therefore I feel that I bore myself, but I'll try to do my best. What is the function of a harmonization committee? The harmonization committee is called upon to provide for the coherency of a text. It's not only a matter of constitutions, it's also a matter of international treaties. The reason why we have such, that we call them drafting committees, the reason there is different, or slightly different. I was part of the drafting committee on the Law of the Sea Convention. I suffered many hours in this committee, for we wanted to harmonize the different languages texts. This convention is being drafted allegedly in 7 languages. De facto, it has been drafted in mostly 1, but it also authentic in Arabic, Chinese, French, Spanish, English, I hope, and Russian. Once the chairman of the committee gave me a or us rather, a paper which had a Russian text, a Chinese text, and an Arabic text. And we had to establish whether these three texts were coherent amongst themselves, and then with English, French, and Spanish. I could hardly assume how to hold the paper, whether this way or the other way. But we were saved by a member of my delegation who spoke in mother tongue Mandarin, who spoke fluent Arabic, and who equally spoke fluent Russian. And he pointed out to the concern of the chairman, saying, here, the Arabic is wrong. That's a grammatical error. And there, the text has mistakes, and there the text in Mandarin is not elegant. And this already describes the function of such a committee. Namely, first, to look into the text, whether the text reflects the proper language, in your case, Spanish, if we speak about the Constitution. I don't know the Spanish you are speaking about in Chile. You just said that the Spanish in Chile is awful, I doubt it, but be it as it may, in many countries, including my own, the real text, let me speak about German, the German text is not the German text which is spoken, let's put it this way, on the marketplace. We use a different German if it comes to legal texts. I know it, I'm very heavily involved in drafting a constitution in Sudan, and there my team speaks fluent Arabic, even a very good Arabic, but they don't speak the legal Arabic in Sudan. That is for them something they can't know, they don't know, for they come from Syria, Lebanon, and Tunisia. Amongst themselves, they communicate also the Arabic in these countries is again different. Therefore, the function of a drafting committee or a harmonization committee, I'll come to Chile in a moment, is first of all to make sure that the language is being used, a proper language is being used. In international treaties, we achieve this by, in Article 1 mostly, by giving a glossary. But if you care to look into the law of the Sea Convention, you don't even define what is a ship. Now you will say, we all know what a ship is. Do you? I could test you, and I would show you that you don't know. There are different meanings where you can question whether this is a ship or not a ship. And unfortunately, this has become quite relevant since we have new vehicles at sea which are underwater and unmanned. These are drones. Are they ships? Let's leave it aside. That's one. However, this is for national texts, it is equally or even more important that the text as such is coherent. Chile is a republic, you will all agree. Could somebody of you describe to me what is a republic? We take that for granted that we all know what is a republic. And in literature, I know a colleague who says republic is the equivalent to democracy. If you go to the Latin roots, that's correct, still it's wrong. Republic, in my view, means no king or queen. But there are other views. But we take it for granted when in the common constitution you speak of the Republic of Chile, we mean all the same. Wait and see what the academic world is going to make out of it. And then the question is less simple, that you must have a structure in the constitution which has a certain consequence. There are many different ways how to construe a constitution. You can start with the organization. You can start with the human rights. You can start with principles and whatsoever. I trained under the German system. I always start with the most general terms. As this is typical for somebody trained on the basis of Roman law. But that's not the only option. Now, the harmonization committee of this convention should do all that. Now, I have in front of me, and perhaps you have it also on your computers, the articles approved by the Constitutional Convention up until 27 March. And I would try to bring to your attention one particular provision and question it from the point of view of drafting, for it is not the mandate of the drafting commission to change some things in substance. Perhaps I stop at that point before I go to these articles. Since you mentioned that, sure, there are certain practice. We have analyzed the practice of several states, Tunisia, for example, Egypt, and others. The practice doesn't help you much. You see quite significant differences. Most drafting committees are small. Yours will be significantly 40, and therefore rather big. Today I was asked, should we not split the drafting committee into committees? My answer, as you remember, was, don't add, please, to the confusion. You have enough committees already. For the drafting committee, and that's one point, has to unify things, and if they work against in committees, they will not unify, they make it even more complicated. But that's my personal view. Therefore, looking into past practice of other states, perhaps we have not looked into the constitutions of 193 states. Some have no constitution, which we therefore we can't look into that. But what is counting is only the practice of the states who have recently adopted new constitutions. But I will show you that in former times, one drafting committee did a job, good job, an essential job, otherwise I might not have been here with you, for it's on the German Constitution. I give you on that very basis, since I'm not meant to speak much more than a quarter of an hour, and we should rather have an interactive discourse, I read out to you two provisions. Chile is a regional, plurinational, and intercultural state made of autonomous territorial entities within a framework of equity, solidarity among them all, preserving the unity and integrity of the state. I leave out the last sentence for it doesn't fit you, belong into this article. And the next article, I only read the first two lines. The state is territorially organized into autonomous regions, autonomous communes, indigenous territorial autonomies, and special territories. Now, if you wish, my colleague who speaks Spanish could read it out to you in Spanish. I do that only in English. Is this good drafting? When last time speaking to the members of the assembly, I didn't make it a fake question. I really insisted that the answer, I will not do that to you. The members of the Constitutional Assembly are younger, and at least the age difference between them and me is so big that they were slightly puzzled, astonished, but they give good answers. Now let us analyze what is the content of this And how should it read if we accept the content, but put it in the proper wording? It is not for the drafting committee to change the substance. That is clear. Although drafting or harmonizing and modifying the substance is only shades of, but be it as it may. I would say that this drafting of these two provisions I read out is not as it could be. The content for me is clear, but do you believe somebody who is not trained in law would understand what is being said there? Sure, a constitution will not be easy reading. It's not a Mickey Mouse brochure, but it should at least, it's the soul of a country. It should be understandable by even people who are not lawyers and even people who are not organized academics or whatsoever. Therefore, I would rather propose a different reading. I would, first of all, change the sequence. For there is a duplication. The state is territorially organized into autonomous regions, autonomous communes, territorial autonomies, and special territories. You could rephrase as to say, the state is, the state of Chile, I would say, is territorially organized in regions, communes, they have forgotten something, municipalities, indigenous territorial, indigenous areas, and special territories. All these are autonomous. Now it's somewhat clearer. Instead of using autonomous four times in the same sentence, that doesn't make sense. Apart from that, autonomous is a very important element, and therefore by separating and putting it in a second sentence, you emphasize. Let's not forget, different drafting also puts an emphasis on certain words, and autonomy is a very important word. From the rest, you can see this country will be built from the municipality. Therefore, it should read, the state of Chile is territorially organized into municipalities, regions, here it says communes, and the state, as well as indigenous areas and special territories, and they all enjoy, perhaps not the least, letter one, autonomy. Is this understandable? Now this, or something equivalent, should be produced by the commission. Why is this necessary? What is very clear, this is based in the rules of procedure here in the Chilean convention, they work via committees. That's an idea, I don't know where it came from, or I have my suspicion, but that's besides the point. For then certain forces have a better influence, and there is no, in this case, as in other cases, no direct cooperation, exchange of views between the committees. Therefore, what is being done in committee on, let's say, principles, is also being done to a certain extent the state. Therefore, one and five is overlapping significantly. And there are other overlaps. And as long as they don't talk to each other, and they're not supposed to, they will come up with duplications and even differences. Now, what is a drafting committee meant to do? they should clean up the text, and then it will be sent back to the plenary. The plenary may accept these changes, and then another particularity, they vote upon each single article, but not on the whole of the text. This is the incentive to be specialized, and the only, so to speak, moderating system in that respect is the Committee on Harmonizing the Text. This poor commission or committee will have probably 3 days to do this job. I can only say I'm happy I'm not in this committee, for it's near to impossible. They should start, and they should, they were meant to start only when the whole text is in front of them. But in the moment, they have perhaps 75%, perhaps not even that. Therefore, they can hardly start. For if you start doing it here, but there may be other provisions which come in from other committees who have not submitted their provisions to the plenary, and therefore the whole work can be ruined. My suggestion would be, since one cannot change in the last minute the rules of procedure, that at least I believe would be very counterproductive and would create a suspicion that the whole process is being manipulated. Therefore, they must find some means to do some work before they know the whole text. Therefore, they should go here through all these provisions. Some of these provisions are absolutely perfectly well drafted. I can give you one if I find it. Also the human rights part. You remember which I meant? But it doesn't matter. Cultural rights. Be it as it may, but many of the texts are of that kind. And this is due to a fact which is common in constitutional lawmaking. If you don't agree, you go up another level in abstractness. If there is no agreement, you go even one step further into abstractness. That makes harmonization rather complicated. So far, what we learn here is a question of proper drafting on what the result is fixed. And this is a complicated issue. And please believe me, at the end of the day, this constitution is a superior law of the land. And there will be the jurisprudence of the Constitution Court. I know there was a discussion whether it will remain, but it seems it will remain. And therefore, there will be a, let's put it this way, the legislation and the executive will be ascertain their acts on the basis of this document. Therefore, the question of harmonizing the text to read as a proper text is one of the most important elements. One should, apart from that, I've been all my life, apart from being academic, a judge, national or international, one should not lead important decisions to judges. That's my belief. One should leave it to those who have the legitimacy to develop the law. The judges should only apply the law. Sure, I know. It's between application and development, there's also no very clear limit. But be as it may, that's another problem. Thank you for an introduction, and I hope it will trigger some kind of a discussion.
Con ese gran consejo le agradecemos al profesor Wolfram por su presentación y le damos la palabra.
Professor Wolfram, and now we will give the floor to Valeria. Thank you for being with us. Hello, you can hear me? Yes. Thank you for the invitation. It's an honor to be here and to provide some comments and reflect regarding the comments of Professor Rüdiger Wolfram. I don't know if I am able to do it, but if I am invited, maybe I can. It comforts me to hear his words, because every time we think about the harmonization process in Chile, and that is going to be quite complex, today I think that now is one of the main concerns regarding the process. He told us about experiences that the confusion of the languages, not just the expressions, are of essential role. So I feel optimistic about the experience in Chile. Now me, as a political commentator, I have to focus on what the professor was saying regarding this gray area that the harmonization process involves, that at first you think that this is a process of choosing the legally correct words, using proper language, as the professor mentioned, and that, without a doubt, is an important function that the Harmonization Commission does. But as he was pointing out, this is a gray area, because we also know that the selection of one word or another word has consequences, sometimes very big consequences. And this may be a bigger or smaller problem according to the context. Unfortunately, the context that we have here with this conventional constitution has not been the best civic friendship environment, and it's not very trust. There's not a trustworthy environment. There's an environment of a lot of mistrust between the constituents. And we all know about the distrust that, according to me, it's justified. The indigenous people representatives, that they feel persecuted throughout the whole history by the state. So I was reading recently something that pointed out some of the indigenous people constituents, and one of the words that that we saw here in this very key word, territory, and the importance of using the word territory instead of land. And right, it's a good thing that I read that, because I wouldn't have known, and I recognize that I'm ignorant in this subject. These subtleties between territory and land might make a big difference, and that is exactly the point that several constituents mentioned in this story in a newspaper, that also pointed out the importance of this commission, that they have experts, people with technical capabilities, you might think in lawyers, that might provide some technical adequacy to the text, but also the importance that we have experts in the subjects, people that may put into context why the choice of this word and not another, that might help to create more trust. I think the most important choice, possibly, that we are facing now in more procedure matters very soon, is to decide, that the convention itself decides who is going to be in this commission. The number is quite big. You usually think about commissions in subjects in which the work is more productive if there are few people, because having agreements with fewer people is easier than having a larger number of people to generate agreements and to create trust. It's easier with less people. But at the same time, when I was thinking about this, I was also thinking about that without a big number, in this case 40, it would be difficult that all of these different groups are represented, directing different words and providing different visions and different sensibilities, that it is also important that they are respected. Because again, we cannot forget about the one of the main objectives that this convention and this effort of the country to have a new constitution is the one of resetting trusts, give legitimacy to a system that has lost it. So one way of doing this is that the process itself, this process that some may agree with, some others may not, but we have a convention that represents the Chilean population at large, as a whole, and as it has never been represented. In higher or lower degree, is replicated in the commissions. So it's a good thing that we can replicate this in this harmonization commission that will absolutely be key. All of this to say that you might expect smaller commissions, more feasible for the work. In this case, possibly it would be wiser, and maybe it was a good decision of the convention, again, that understands better that most of us as analysts, what are those sensibilities that are at stake, that are now being confronted? Of course, all of this makes things more complicated. It doesn't make them easier. And I think it's even more complicated. I had the chance yesterday of speaking with a constituent from Colombia that was telling me about how easy it was to work on the Harmonization Commission in Colombia, that they worked very well, how fluent it was to reach agreements regarding the special words and the ways of expressing the text and whatnot. And how different is the dynamic that you might imagine for the Harmonization Commission here? And hopefully I'm wrong, but it is different. It's a very different dynamic when, again, the mistrust is such an important issue. We have a convention whose biggest advantage to return the legitimacy to the system in Chile is very diverse. It is very representative, descriptively, of the Chilean population. So these are strengths. But when generating agreements, when it comes to sharing visions, sharing languages even, it's a complication. So we see different dimensions, different layers in which we can see that the harmonization process of the text in Chile is going to be complicated. I hope, and I share this opinion, that it would be a good thing that in this commission, hopefully we can have legal experts, we might say lawyers, but also that we have enough people in there to safeguard all the sensibilities that might not be as important or wouldn't be as damaging if they were vulnerated. So this would be a wasted work, right? Those are some of my concerns. I think that the presentation of Professor Wolfram, I think he addressed all the important points that are most worrisome here in Chile, and particularly about this point of sensibilities. I would like to know if he has any opinion, maybe from his experience. I would like to know what he thinks about this aspect. Thank you. Thank you so much, Valeria. Samuel, the floor is yours. Okay, you can hear me now. First of all, thank you for this invitation from the CEP to hear this very interesting conference with Professor Rüdiger Wolfram and Valeria's intervention. These two interventions, we can see different aspects of the Harmonization Commission and the challenge that they have to face. I'll address only one aspect about something that I think it's not being emphasized enough. The Harmonization Commission represents, I would say, a unique opportunity in the debate and regarding the Constitution. This commission of 40 constituents that the convention will choose regarding the sponsorships will be the only moment of deliberation in the convention that will be done already knowing the Constitution as a whole. In fact, we are now getting to the final weeks of the constitutional discussion. We haven't even discussed the political regime in this plenary. Hopefully next week we can have the rotation of the political organization. So we have many things to expect. We know that the commissions are going to be voted and then presented to the plenary. But as I said before, this will only be done once the Commission of Harmonization will start working, is that within the Constitution Convention, we will know the text as a whole. And as Professor Wolfram and Professor Palanza have highlighted, up to now the discussion has been more disaggregated in different commissions that they present these different reports to the plenary. So they have been tested. All these regulations that we've tested and we've tried on the draft of the Constitution, but there hasn't been a global discussion. So from that point of view, I would say that the Harmonization Commission cannot only limit it to take care of the technical aspects of the text article by article, but this is a unique opportunity of seeing how the different elements of the articles and chapters and different sections are consistent or they create a coherent structure for the Constitution. So I would expect that the Commission, in the last interventions, we can see that they will only have 3 weeks and then they will have 5 days more to choose the right text. So they're very time constrained to do this harmonization, along with the political restrictions. The convention, as we know, is very fragmented in different political groups. There's a lot of mistrust, as Valeria mentioned before, between the constituents. But I would say that it would be a shame that this opportunity is not taken advantage of. As Title number 6 states, that regulates the tasks of the Harmonization Commission. So I would expect that we not only focus on the usage of the language on a micro level, but also this consistency and technical quality that we expect of the Constitution on a macro level. So I would also like to add this additional element to the discussion. And those are my comments, so we can have a more fluent conversation. Thank you, Samuel. I don't know, Professor, if you want to address any of the comments. I don't know if we have questions from the audience. Here we're approaching with the mic. The first question comes from Aldo. Thank you, everyone, for your comments. But I'm very interested in the opposition between Professor Wolfram's presentation and the position that Samuel takes regarding the convention, because I don't know if they seem contradictory, but at least they seem different. In the case of Professor Wolfram, there's an emphasis on the semantics. You placed a lot of emphasis in the no big changes were happening there, but a position as Samuel's has to do with the constitutional architecture, where there could be important changes or major changes in the way in which the different elements are integrated. So, Professor, I wanted to ask you, according to your experience, have there been harmonization commissions, and in which cases and in which measures, in which there has been this architectural changes that involve an important transformation of what was done originally by the constituents? In which cases has this happened? Before giving the floor to the speakers, one final question from Aldo, from the Democracy Challenges Institute. Yes. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for providing the opportunity to attend this seminar. I wanted to ask Professor Wolfram to delve deeper in the more technical aspects of legislative drafting, of what we have observed on the articles that we already know, that are final, that are part of the text that the Harmonization Commission will present. You can already observe a wide drafting of what is being articulated. And we can see also a challenge regarding economy in the writing. That on one hand, and on the other hand, there's this sort of technical assistance to clarify the meaning of the words that the convention has been wanting to use, maybe without knowing the consequences of these terms. Internationally, for example, regarding the treaties and conventions that Chile has signed, and this process, who is responsible for this? Is it responsibility of the 40 constituents that will be part of this commission, or do we have to have a technical consultancy professional that maybe they can consult and assist and ultimately create the technical conditions that would allow them to deliberate? Thank you, Aldo. I don't know, Professor, if you would like to start?
Sí. Committee was quite unclear. It was called upon by the governments of the states. Germany had been rebuilt from the municipality to the Länder, and these were the governments of the Länder. They appointed two experts, mostly legal experts or administrative experts, to draft a new German constitution. It's referred to as the draft of Herrn Chiemsee, sorry for that name. Mm-hmm. It refers to an island. There's a castle of the crazy Bavarian king, Ludwig II, the castle is nearly finished, and there they had a good piece of, a castle to sit together, to draft, etc. They drafted their text in 2 weeks. That's a very technical draft. It is a complete, nearly complete constitution, except it did not have anything on human rights. It has more the organizational set. This draft was handed over to the Constitutional Assembly, which was elected upon by the parliaments of the lender. By the way, perhaps you know, Konrad Adenauer, first chancellor, was a president of this assembly. He was an old fox, and therefore knew what he did. For when he was taking this job, he was already pretty old and had behind himself a career as the first mayor of the city of Cologne, and he had been the president of the Council of the States, Reichsrat. Therefore, he was quite experienced. Apart from that, he was a very good lawyer. Now, the rules of procedure were adopted in this Constitutional Assembly within 2 or 3 days. Why that? They did what this convention could have done too. They took the rules of procedure of a parliament. That was it. This was very clever. Few adjustments, this was done. That saves time. Then there was a political agreement between all parties in parliament. On the right wing, the Deutsche Partei, German political party, and on the left, the communists. Every of these parties got the chairmanship of one committee. This was done on purpose. The work was done in the committees, and Adenauer made sure that he got the most important committee. The SPD made a mistake and got a totally insignificant. SPD and CDU were more or less same strength. Now, at the end of the debate and everything, there were the following issues not resolved: the type of federalism, the functioning of the second chamber, the central bank business, and these were the major ones, and the electoral system. For example, the SPD wanted proportional elections, the CDU majority election in districts. The central bank, the CDU wanted to be independent, the SPD not. The CDU was in favor of a strong federalism, or the SPD not, and so on. I could continue. Now, what was possible in this drafting committee, and therefore looking into the rules is totally unnecessary, for the practices was count. This was not in the rules. The party heads came together and did a bargain. You get that, we get that, and the others get that. This possibility does not exist for you here, for you can't do packages in this committee. This is unfortunate. The constitution, at the end of the day, is always a compromise. Let's not assume that we have a perfect constitution which comes directly from nowhere. No, it's man-made, and man-made there are disagreements, and you overcome them by compromises. There was, at the end of that, only one problem left: our electoral system. For the SPD was very strong on the proportional system, and the CDU was very strong on the majority principle. What did they do? They accepted both. But to please the SPD, otherwise it would have not accepted that, only for the next elections. And the next parliament, the real federal parliament, then would decide on the electoral system. It was just by chance, it was this two systems, this parallel system, every German has two votes, therefore you can vote in the second vote for SPD and in your first vote for a candidate from, let's say, the CDU. That's totally all right. Our German population has understood that. We have only a limited amount of invalid votes. Well, this makes counting a little bit complicated, but the parliament thereafter decided we keep that system. And it's now being adopted by New Zealand and some other countries. Therefore, the most important thing in these drafting committees is to give a certain leeway for compromises or, to put it in the international law terminology, package deals. You, at the end of the day, you vote for the whole constitution, and you have and should have so much in favor that it outweighs what you dislike. That is a bargain. You can't have, and Sir Walter cannot have, a constitution where he or she says, I like everything. But for that, you have to have such a mechanism. I hope I answered your question, but nobody else did it that way. You have a point. Indigenous people, or who was it, prefer the word land over territory. Now, international instruments speak of the land, but the word territory has one particularly. It means not only the land, but also the land in certain borders. And when the indigenous speak about land, they mean the whole land, land as a mystic figure. And if we write into a legal text the territory, we mean that the indigenous would have particular rights in respect of certain land. That is the difference. I have been in touch with indigenous people, not only here with the Mapuche, but also in the American system in particular. But you have a point that should be reconsidered, and perhaps one should use a term which is covering both. That's a question of terminology. One should have look into that. The question on treaties, if I understood the question correctly, it refers to the fact that Chile might be a highly decentralized, or will be a highly decentralized state, with a central state, the national state, with rather limited competences. But the competences certainly will include international treaties. However, it has not yet been fully cleared, so there are no provisions on the functions of the national level. What are the functions of the national level? Will there be a foreign minister? And if so, how do you integrate the region and the municipalities, if you want that, into the treaty negotiations or treaty making? It's a real problem, but it can easily be overcome. There will be a second chamber, namely a chamber of regents, or governors rather, and if you give them the right to participate or to decide on the ratification of an international treaty, you have involved at least the regions. I don't think it will be necessary to involve municipalities, but you can and should do so. We have that problem in Germany. What is if the city of Constance wants to build around the Lake Constance a sewage system, a circle around the lake, so that new sewage goes into the lake. That means to include the municipalities of Switzerland, rather complicated, Austria, less complicated, Bavaria, extremely complicated, and Baden-Württemberg, rather easygoing. But it has been done. We provide in Germany to the municipalities certain rights to get into international agreements with the other side. If this was easy, they all speak German, even the Swiss, and it would be much more complicated if the other side is France, not due to the language, that's not a big issue. But the French system is centralized. As you remember, Austria, Switzerland, and Germany are all decentralized, all federal states. Therefore, it fits. But the agreement on concerning fighting fires across the border with France has to be decided for France in Paris and for Germany wheresoever, probably in Stuttgart. Therefore, how do you deal with that? We have the solution that there will be a delegation from Stuttgart to Paris, and in Paris there will be the French central power, and in Stuttgart, from Stuttgart, there will be the power of Baden-Württemberg. But the Foreign Office will send an observer into that delegation so that the two central powers speak on the same level, although the Foreign Office has no rights in the substance. Therefore, you can do all that, but this is not an issue of the Constitution, that's an issue of practical experience and laws. Therefore, it's feasible. I hope I understood your question rightly, but I could, if so, then I believe I could explain how this can be done.
Muchas gracias, profesor.
Thank you so much. Valeria, please, do you want to... Yes, I'd like to. Please. Do we have time? Okay, so yes, while we're here, okay, we continue thinking and reflecting, right? And in the midst of all these concerns that sometimes you're so involved with what's happening in a committee, in this convention, right? And at this specific point in time, and you're called to speak about something and you do so. But then, even at this point in time where Chile, right, is sitting down to draft this new constitution. As I said before, it's a difficult point in time. I think we must not lose sight of regarding some limitations, of course, we'd all like to have a properly drafted constitution and technically for it to be a good instrument, right? And but also we want to have an agreement. And we also want for the citizens to reach this new agreement, so and also this matter of legitimacy, which has to be refounded. And as a professor was saying before, every constitutional text, right, includes negotiations. There are trade-offs as well. Some matters that are compromised in exchange for others. And possibly we may have to accept this effect of having a text that is less technical, of good technical quality, to have a text that is an text that citizens can recognize as this agreement they need. Now, nothing guarantees, right, that having a technically not of the best quality or low technical quality text is going to indeed give us this legitimacy and these agreements we need so much as a country. But I do believe that if that's that okay, what is considered from both sides, what is at stake, and if someone were to ask me what's most important for Chile, okay, I'd say, of course, I'd like to have a less refined text and some gray areas that the justice will have to define moving forward, or that the legislative branch will have to address over time. And instead of having an homogeneous, well-drafted text, and which is not legitimate, or which is not considered by the citizens as legitimate. So, I mean, let's not lose sight of the fact why we're here changing the constitution. Let's not lose sight of the limitations we face. And logically, this is not a call for us to be like the quality of the text doesn't matter, no. But to have some priorities to consider. Okay, thank you so much, Valeria. Samuel, I'm not sure if you'd like to say something. Microphone, please. I cannot hear properly. Okay, regarding a question from Aldo. Effectively, as said by Professor Wolfram, this general rule of the convention literacy establishes the harmonization committee that they cannot alter, and these indications of harmonization, they already approve the norms. And of course, how can they fulfill the role of addressing inconsistencies and safeguard the technical quality of the text without proposing any alteration to the already approved norms? And I think this is going to be a political matter. Actually, the report from the Harmonization Committee has to be approved by a two-thirds majority of the plenary. And unfortunately, as said by Professor Wolfram in his last intervention, the way in which the report is going to be voted, this is not like a whole, so this is going to be pretty difficult to negotiate this big package. I mean, this is going to be voted by indication, and also indications that didn't specify any corrections are proposed the text. And even then, there is this period, so constituents, with support of 16 constituents can propose alternative indications or different to those proposed by the Harmonization Committee. So this multiplication of indications may happen, and these are going to have to be voted one by one, and whatever the report of the committee tried to harmonize and to restructure, and also to give some coherence, is broken down by the way in which these various indications are approved or rejected, depending on the case. And this is a problem, and of course, it makes it really difficult to negotiate a package, to vote an indication beforehand, which I'm only approving because another group that I don't trust is going to approve another indication in the future. So it's not an easy task. What is the only chance we have to review the Constitution once we have this project? I know we don't have as much time. There is a lot of mistrust. And we are going to have a constitutional project which is going to be tremendously regulatory. I mean, it wouldn't be strange for this new Constitution to quadruple the current Constitution to be four times as larger. So there are going to be inconsistencies in the way in which the texts have been written. And there are lots of time constraints, last-minute agreements, indications. There are going to be inconsistencies as well, and design issues as well, of constitutional design. So I think this hope on the Harmonization Committee, hopefully, is not going to be in vain. But it's not an easy task. And okay, on this hopeful note, unfortunately, We have to finalize this seminar, and there were so many issues to be addressed. But thank you so much, Professor Wolfram, Professor Apalanza, and Professor Chorny, for joining us today. Thank you so much to all of you that followed us through social media. And on behalf of the Institute of Challenges for Democracy with the Center of Public Studies, thank you so much. And hope we can see each other again soon. Have a great night.